Johnson. Who? Ladies and gentlemen, please stand.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Captain Sean Brown of the Education and Training Section. On behalf of the Police Commissioner, I would like to welcome you to the graduating ceremony of Class 2017-01. I ask that you remain standing and greet our honored graduates. The class colors will be borne by Officer Hertz. Star Spangled Banner will be sung by Detective Nigel Rose, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Command, class, detail, ready, face, present, who?
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light? What so proudly we
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We will begin our ceremony tonight with an invocation from Police Chaplain Reverend Selwyn Ray.
May bow heads.
Oh yeah. We're gonna have two prayers.
Okay, they said you were heads to the table.
Two prayers. Amen. Thank you for the covering that even happened, where there are obviously two or more gathered in your name. We thank you for the fact that we have leadership on this stage in the form of a mayor, a very graceful and gracious and intelligent mayor, in the form of a newly minted police commissioner. Again, graceful and gracious. But we ask one thing as we gather and even gently hear the chatter of children behind us, which remind us why we're here. We ask us to call on the master of the universe to provide a spirit of unity, a spirit of togetherness, and an aggressive spirit of progress as we take this city to a new level of peace, prosperity, and of course, sanctity. We call on your name right now to begin this celebration of graduation as we move forward, but ask as we leave this place that we keep this prayer in mind, that we need your mercy right now, we call on your mercy right now, and we actually challenge ourselves to be obedient to your calling to unify and be one city. In your precious name we pray, oh God, amen.
At this time, it is my honor and privilege to introduce the 50th Mayor of Baltimore City, Mayor Catherine Pugh.
Good evening, everyone. Okay, Major Roden, thank you for the introduction. And let me take a moment to acknowledge and congratulate our Commissioner-designee, D'Souza. Thank you for all that you are doing, and more importantly, for all that you will do. Let me also say to, I think we have on the stage with us, Councilman Brandon Scott, representing all of the council persons in our city. Is anybody else up here? No, okay. And to all the command staff and officers of the Baltimore Police Department, thank you all for being here as well. But let me also take a moment to thank all the family and the friends who are here, because I know that this graduation represents a milestone in the lives of the individuals who sit before us. But what I want you all to know, especially those who are graduating today, that you did not get here by yourself. There were family members, there are friends, loved ones who prayed for you every day, who hoped that you would reach this milestone. And while I attended your badge and gun ceremony, I am also grateful to be here today to watch you all graduate and become full-fledged members of the Baltimore Police Department. Let me say to the 42 graduates, this is class 1701, 9 of you are Baltimore City residents, 10 have prior military records, 1 actually lived directly across the street from me, I watched him grow up from the age of 10 and on. He actually carried, Commissioner, the flag for me when I became a city councilman. But I know there are many stories sitting down in front of me. But what I want you all to know is that you are about to take on one of the toughest positions in the city. But it is also a very honorable position, because you all are sworn and will be sworn to protect the lives of the citizens of Baltimore. But what we want you to know is that when you leave your homes, your family's hearts, your friends' hearts leave with you. And I want you to know that we all will pray for you every single day. And so families, while you stand here or sit here and witness this milestone in the lives of the loved ones that you trust to lead our city, we ask that you continue to pray as well. Know that we will do everything we can to lift them up and to push them forward. We recognize that they've taken on a great responsibility in a city that has many challenges. But what we want you to know is that we're invested in you. And as the mayor of this city, my commitment is to continue to invest in you, to make sure that this department has the greatest technology of any police department in the country, that we make sure that you have every opportunity to live in our city as well as to work in our city. So parents and friends, you should know that there are tax credits for individuals who are sitting in front of us to buy homes in our city. We're also coming up with tax credits for those who want to rent in our city. We want to protect our young men and women who have chosen this profession to be public servants for the city of Baltimore. We know that you will do it with honor and with pride. And we will respect you as you will respect the members of our communities that you will come in contact with every day. We ask you to make sure that you understand that every individual in this city deserves respect. And we expect our community to show their respect for you. So I applaud you for choosing this profession. More importantly, I look forward to your future. I look forward to your grace. I look forward to your commitment. I bless you. I will pray for you every single day. I look forward to these men and women assuming the positions of police officers in the Baltimore Police Department. And I look forward to saying congratulations when you are fully pledged. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Pugh. Next, it's my honor and privilege to introduce to you the Commissioner of the Baltimore Police Department, Commissioner Daryl D. D'Souza.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Afternoon, sir.
You guys ready to graduate?
Yes, sir.
Sure about that?
Yes, sir.
I gotta ask your parents' permission first. Are they ready to graduate?
Yes.
Who said no? Stand up, and we're going to make sure they get recycled right here. Whose mom is that right there? That's somebody's sister. I can't see that far. So before I get started, I want to just recognize a few more people that's on the stage. I know Councilman Schiffler came up from behind the curtain. He was hiding there. Welcome. And I want to also say that Chief from Anne Arundel County Police is here, Chief Baker, who is a retired Baltimore City Commander. And I'd like to say also on the stage is a mentor of mine for 30 years, one of my mentors. And I hope that you guys will do the same thing that I did as a young officer, as I sat there in your very seat sometime in 1989. I'm giving my age away here. But in 1989, I sat somewhere, D'Souza was probably somewhere right around here, I think it was. So I would really hope that you guys would attach yourself to this greatest command staff. And please give them a hand, because they are the greatest command staff in the country. So I truly hope that not next week or not 2 months from now, not 6 months from now, immediately you attach yourself to one of these commanders here like I did 30 years ago. So on the stage also is my mentor for 30 years, retired police commissioner from the Baltimore City Police Department, and chief of Coppin State University's Lenny Hamm. I want to talk about a couple of things. I want to make it really clear. First thing I want to talk about is when and now. So when I say when now, you probably think I'm talking about a basketball game or a football game or the Super Bowl or some event that's going to happen sometime next week, right? That's probably what you guys are thinking. And the command staff were probably laughing behind me because they heard the same story many times before. When I say WIN now, it's six letters, WIN. And what does WIN mean? It's an acronym for what's important now. And a lot of teams, you heard it, a lot of teams, NFL, NBA, different places in businesses have it. And what does WIN mean? It means what's important now. And what's important now for you guys right now is that you graduate, that you get your assignments, which is going to be on foot in the community, learning community policing, that you go home each and every day, take that uniform off or on each day, and wear it proudly, embrace your family, tell them each and every day that you love them, but more importantly is that it's your responsibility each and every day to create what I call the pathway to the community with the most integrity, period, with the most reform, period. You are the first group graduating. What I'm saying this message is that we are gonna reform this police department to the once great department where it was in the past. And it's your responsibility when you guys hit the streets this week. I know you guys are gonna probably be off tomorrow, but you're gonna be working Sunday and Monday on foot in the community, and it's your responsibility to WIN, okay? The second thing is now. So what does now mean?
Couldn't tell you, sir.
All right. It's no opportunity wasted. No opportunity wasted. So when you wear that uniform and you go to your districts or you're walking foot, that everything that you do is the pathway to the community. That every single thing that you do is that you don't waste a single opportunity making a positive relationship to people in the community, the citizens in the community is very critical. And what's more critical is our young men and young women in the community because they need us. So I was away for about 12 months and I did a listening tour when I did a fellowship at the International Association for Chiefs of Police. I came back to Baltimore in April or May, right before school let out, and I did a listening tour. I went to three colleges, Coppin State University, Howard University, and University of Baltimore. I went to three high schools, and I went to three middle schools in Baltimore. And I did a listening tour, and you guys are gonna participate in that same listening tour before you even step foot in a district and step foot in a patrol car. And what does a listening tour mean? It means that you're gonna listen. You're gonna listen to the needs of the community. So I did that with various groups. I spent time with them, young kids, in their own school, listening to their voices. And some of the major takeaways that I got from that is very heartfelt. So when we did this listening tour, we did an icebreaker. And the icebreaker, as they sat down, these young men and young women in high school, and I said to them, and in the middle school, I said to them, please describe to me a safe place. Like, describe your safe place. Where is it? And all the hands went up immediately, and moms and dads and parents back there. And I just want you to think about the same thing also, if I'm asking you, and if I'm doing a listening tour myself, like describe a safe place. Well, there was a young man, raised his hand, and you know what he said his safe place was? He said his safe place was in heaven. So what that meant to me was that he felt unsafe in his own community. He felt that he probably was in a better place in heaven than on earth here. And you know what? I know you guys aren't counselors. I know you guys don't work in the medical profession. We're police officers, and it's our responsibility to make that young man feel safe here in Baltimore City. The other thing I would say that I took away from that is that, and that same icebreaker questions, and grandmas, just stand up or raise your hand for me real quick. Any grandmothers here? There's quite a few. So when we talk to these young kids and we ask them a safe place, they said with their grandmothers. That was the number one response. Really didn't hear moms a whole lot, but we heard grandmothers. All right. God bless you, grandmoms. So in this listening tour, it was based on three questions. Describe the relationship between the police and your community. What do you need from the police? And what particular program do you think would be beneficial in bridging the gap between youth and police? So the first one, when I asked them, describe their relationship with you and the police in your community, you know what the response was? They really didn't have one. That's your responsibility to make that happen. The second thing we asked them was, what do you need from the police? And you know what they said? They want a relationship. But guess what? That's your responsibility to do that. The third thing that we asked the young men and young women was, what particular program or event that you can do, that we can do collectively, that would bridge the gap? And you know what they said? They said they want police to be our mentors. So guess what? You're gonna have a mentor here on this stage by the time this evening is over. And my expectation for you is to embrace a young man or a young woman in Baltimore City and mentor them. Because I'm gonna check back in about 6 months just to make sure you guys have done that. So I gotta give all the respect for Madam Mayor. I think she is the greatest mayor in the US. She's very innovative. I want to thank her so much for giving me the opportunity to stand here and to represent the Baltimore City Police Department. Ma'am, thank you so much. But I want to say a couple of things. I've been in this position for 24 days. You guys read the news, right? I know they do. In 24 days, it's been a challenge, but it's the opportunity to grow from it. It's an opportunity. In 24 days, yeah, we had, unfortunately, two police-involved shootings. In 24 days, we had 250 individuals that were wanted for either murder, aggravated assault, shooting, burglary, robbery, larceny. In 24 days, these commanders on their stage, their officers made 250 more warrant arrests in 24 days. It's amazing. What also happened in 24 days is that we managed to reduce the homicides by 35%. We managed to reduce the non-fatal shootings by 47%. You guys are gonna have to continue that. Today I met with an organization in my office also in 24 days right before your graduation. It's A Mother's Pride. And it was really touching. I invited them to the graduation. I'm not sure if they're still here, I can't see, but one of the young ladies, she came and she was teary-eyed, and she told me about how she lost her son last year. And when I did a double take, Mel, are you here, Mel? When I did a double take, I realized who she was. When she said her name, I looked a little bit closer, and I won't share her name, but I actually knew her when she was 17 years old. And to see her from the age of 17 and to see her in pain today, it goes to show you that there's a lot of parents, there's a lot of moms, there's a lot of dads. There's a city out there that needs healing, and it's our responsibility to do that. We gotta do that every day when we come to work. The last thing I wanna talk about, and if they didn't warn you, I do talk a lot. The last thing I wanna share is just a couple of things on, I just recently did a command restructure, and the restructure that I did, I'm happy that this restructure is gonna drive the police department in the right direction. One thing I need you guys to know immediately that's implemented is what's called an overtime abuse unit. And that's gonna get you in trouble. It's gonna get you in trouble abusing overtime, because if you watch the news or read the paper or see what's, or keeping up with current events, it's gonna get you in trouble. And we are now putting mechanisms in place not to catch the overtime abuse on the back end, but to catch the overtime abuse on the front end. So I want you guys to be well aware of that. The other thing is that you can expect is integrity tests to be done each and every day in the city, just to make sure that we're doing our job properly. The other thing that I implemented right away, it's called the Constitutional and Impartial Policing Unit. And I'm not saying that the men and women standing back there on the stage, on the streets, in any of the districts are doing things incorrectly, but we want to make sure that we have mechanisms in place that we're practicing constitutional policing. And the last thing I want to say is in that 24-day period, well, two things, I'll say this first, that there was a house fire. Let me just back up with that one second. when I go back to the restructure, I want to say one thing. We're in Black History Month, and I'm a little bit of a historian, just a little bit. I'm going to embarrass this person just really quick, but I'm a bit of a historian. Chief Hamm can attest to this story when I say it, but the first African-American female on a police department was in 1937. Her name was Violet Rose White. She never went any higher than the rank of lieutenant. I have been here 30 years on this police department. Chief Hamm has been here way longer than me, and I don't think anyone on the stage has been on the job a little bit longer than I have. But in the Baltimore City Police Department, we have never had an African-American commander that went above the rank of major. We had never had that before. And I'm proud to say that today, I promoted the first African-American female to the rank of lieutenant colonel. Stand up, please. She was a little bit teary-eyed earlier when I gave her the news, so I'll embarrass her a little bit, but she's a great lieutenant colonel. She's gonna do fascinating things for you guys. The last thing I wanna say is that in my 24 days, there was an unfortunate incident that happened in West Baltimore. It happened on Mount Street. It happened right across the street from the Western District. It was a house fire. It was about 2 weeks ago, and it was fully engulfed. It was the second floor. There were some heroes that really shined from that event. Unfortunately, what happened was there was a 17-month-old baby, 17-month, and a 2-year-old baby that Madam Mayor and myself, we were at the hospital. In front of us, they both perished from this incident. And that's some of the things that we see, and if they didn't teach you this in the academy, you're gonna quickly learn to find out that there's gonna be some things that's gonna touch your heart in a certain way. I wear this Bronze Star really proudly because I remember it wasn't more than five months that I got out the police academy on Broadway, and it was a house fire, and I ran in and saved a little baby myself that survived, and a grandfather that survived. And I remember running out the house fire, and I remember my sergeant yelling at me saying, D'Souza, why in the world did you do that? Well, that's what I'm supposed to do. And that's what you're all supposed to do. We're supposed to be here to save lives. So I want to say that there's two officers here now, and I want you guys to stand up real quick, and I want you to come to the front of the stage. I'm going out of order a little bit. Come on up, Mac. Come on up, Rutt. This is Sergeant Rakowski. Come on all the way up, please. Mac and Jenko, but we call you Mac, we know that. And Sergeant Rakowski, we know that there is a process that occurs in a police department, a meritorious award, and there's a board that evaluates heroism, that evaluates great work that the men and women do, that they have done, that you guys are about to do. The process is kind of long and it's kind of drawn out. And I told this to the mayor the night of the fire, and she supported this decision 100%. But I think that when you do an act like you did, and although two lives were lost, you did everything possible to save those lives. And because of that, I'm cutting the red tape. There is no long process. And I'm happy to say that today that both of you, along with your lieutenant, and about 11 other officers are gonna receive a Bronze Star. Sergeant Rakowski, come on up. So the last thing I'll say, and again, y'all know I'm long-winded. The last thing I'll say is that to you guys is that, and to moms and dads and brothers and sisters out there, nephews and any family members and friends, that we have a city that needs our help. We can't operate in silos. We have to knock those silos down. We have to work collectively together, and it's going to start with you guys right here in the seat. And like I tell all of you guys, and I tell command staff to the left, Madam Mayor to the right, and so forth, and you parents out there, that if we don't do this together, if we don't ride together, we all going to cry together. So let's make Baltimore City the best city possible. Thank you and congratulations to you.
Thank you, Commissioner DeSouza. I would like to take this opportunity to also recognize Ms. Kathy Krieger from the Maryland Police and Corrections Training Commission that's also seated up on the stage. At this time, I would like to introduce Officer Jake Almack. He will be delivering the class address.